Following her groundbreaking book, Seeds of Terror, an eyewitness account of Al-Qaeda's newest center of operations in Southeast Asia, veteran journalist Maria Ressa has come out with her latest work between covers, 10 Days, 10 Years, from Bin Laden to Facebook, kicking off with a crucial 10 days from the capture of three ABS-CBN media men by the Abu Sayyaf group to efforts to help rescue them in 2008. The book uncovers the links between the different groups sowing violence in the name of jihad and the new technological methods they use to gather membership and funding. So with us on Mornings, the author and Rappler.com CEO and executive director, and of course our former boss, Maria Ressa. Maria, good morning. Thank you for coming over.
Thanks for having me, Pinky.
Welcome back.
It's nice to be back.
Well, I was actually late during Maria's launch because I had work that time. Well, before we get to the meat of the book, how was it? I mean, your launch, you had a lot of friends there, former colleagues from ABS. They were saying you were almost shed a tear during the launch. What happened?
You know, I'd never actually talked about the kidnapping of Sess and Jimmy and Angel. And it was the first time I'd publicly talked about it. Writing about it is very different. First, the book is about these 10 days where we had to get them out. And you know what that was like. But we never talked about it. And so this was the first time I did. And my voice just kept cracking. I didn't cry. I wasn't that emotional. But my God, more emotional than I've ever been.
So actually, for those who may be interested to know what happened to Sess, Angel, and Jimmy back in 2008, it's all here.
It is. It's transcripts.
The crisis committee.
Transcripts of what we did behind the scenes. You know.
So you mean all your overnight stay?
Everything was there. Phone conversations between the kidnappers and the crisis committee. What we had to do to get them out. And then, you know, part of the reason I wanted to write this was 6 months after Sess's kidnapping, three members of the International Committee for the Red Cross, the Red Cross workers, were kidnapped.
Right.
And it took them 6 months to get them out. And during that time, they actually kept coming to us. Some of their officers kept coming to us and asking us, how did you guys do this? And can you help us? Mm-hmm. And of course, we couldn't help them because we were doing the stories on them. But I was telling them what we did. And that's part of it. You know, if someone you love gets kidnapped by the Abu Sayyaf, what do you do? In the Philippines, you tend to go, if you're coming from outside, you go top down. But going top down, going to the authorities in Manila, and then letting them do it, just can take years.
Okay.
Months and years. So that's part of the reason I wrote it. And the other part was, I traced the kidnappers of Sess. I spoke to some of them. Some of them have been killed, but some of them show the connections all the way to the global jihad. For example, there's one guy named Salih Said. Mm-hmm. He was young when he kidnapped Sess, and he was actually the guy who went to their jeep and then pulled them and dragged and pulled them into the forest, right? His father, Muhammad Said, was somebody who's a sub-commander of Radulan Sahiron, the senior-most member of the Abu Sayyaf. His father was most likely trained by Ramzi Youssef, who was behind the 1993 World Trade Center bombing. His uncle was the guy behind 9/11. You know, so it's less than 6 degrees of separation between Sess Drilon and Osama bin Laden.
Yeah, actually, I read that you said that. But let me go back to Maria, to having... I mean, you've written Seeds of Terror. You were the news bureau chief in Jakarta of CNN. I mean, if there's, you know, you'd probably be one of the first people we'd ask about this. But how do you say it in this book that you actually, were you in a way an expert, or you were in the know of how to actually save our colleagues here, Sess, Angel, and Jimmy? I mean, would it have been easier because of your background?
Rather than
somebody
definitely.
Fresh from the cold.
Well, you know, I had help. I mean, Glenda Gloria and Marites Vitug were also managers of ABS at that point, and both of them had written the book about Mindanao before Seeds of Terror. So between the three of us, we knew whom to call, and we knew the situation on the ground. I think I've covered every kidnapping, most every kidnapping, since the Abu Sayyaf began. I mean, I even talked to the foreigner who came in to try to get Waka Oji. This was way before you, in the late 80s.
Yeah.
Waka Oji was a Japanese businessman.
Okay.
Yeah, no, he was a Japanese businessman. And the guy who came in and headed the crisis committee was a swashbuckling British guy who, you know, when I was doing the research for the book, I just thought, my God, some of it we did by luck. Mm. Some of it was experience.
Okay.
But more than anything, what I learned is that it doesn't change. And sometimes, even though it seems like it's getting better, it just gets worse. Because every kidnapping just gives them more money to do the next one.
Right.
Just today, right? Yesterday there was a clash in Holdo.
Right.
They were after the group of Radulan Sahiron, the same guy who kidnapped Seth, Jimmy, and Angel. Radulan Sahiron's group right now is holding several foreigners hostage. Two Europeans, these guys who went bird watching, a Japanese, and a Jordanian. This Jordanian journalist who interviewed Osama bin Laden. The same group that kidnapped Seth. Why are they still there? Why hasn't anything been done? Why haven't they been captured?
Right,
These are the questions I always ask.
Uh-huh. Okay. Aside from that, so we don't give too much away. It's 10 days because of Seth, Jimmy, and Angel. And it's 10 years because...
We launched it on the 10th anniversary of the Bali bombings,
mm-hmm.
October 12th. And, you know, that's also another day I won't forget because about a year before October 12th, 2002, I just had a horrible feeling something was going to happen.
A year before.
Mm-mm. All of the guys who were arrested in connection with Bali were already in the Indonesian police's database. It's just connecting the links. I guess this is why, you know, people always ask me, why do you stay focused on this? Because if you stay focused on it, you can actually help anticipate what will happen. See, I'm getting emotional about this. Because that, you know, part of it is people say, when 9/11 happened, I was on a treadmill in Jakarta, and it was a memory for me. You know, I went back to a 1995 police intelligence document from the first pilot recruited by Al-Qaeda.
So this is 2001.
Well, both 9/11 and October 12th in Bali. Sorry, I jumped.
So, Maria talks about 9/11 in the United States and 9/11 as Southeast Asia, the Bali bombings.
Yeah,
okay.
Both of these events, we looked away. I think that's why they happened. 9/11, 6 years before 9/11, when the World Trade Centers collapsed, police here in Manila had arrested a guy named Abdul Hakim Murad. He is the first pilot recruited by Al-Qaeda. He was here in the Philippines. Khalid Sheikh Mohammed, the guy who was behind 9/11, the architect of 9/11, had an apartment in Ortigas.
Mm-hmm.
And this guy told the police that they had a plan to hijack commercial planes and crash them into buildings. And he even told them what the buildings were. That was 6 years before 9/11 happened. But, you know, because the document came from the Philippine police, the FBI didn't pay that much attention to it. And the U.S. had its own split in intelligence. You know, when I worked on that piece for CNN, it was held by our legal group for almost a week.
Really?
Because they had to make sure it was absolutely accurate.
Yeah.
And before we came out with the correspondent who was working with the FBI certainly got the side of the FBI. That's what I learned.
Okay.
I learned that people are people. The connections are there. If you stay focused and you connect the dots,
mm-hmm.
you will see a picture that you will miss if you look away.
10 years, 10 days, 10 years. Why from Bin Laden to Facebook?
Because now... global counterterrorism agents and the law enforcement around the world have actually succeeded in breaking down, and they've arrested or killed the top leadership of both Al-Qaeda and Jemaah Islamiyah. And here, thank God, in the Philippines, we now have a framework agreement with the MILF. Starting in 2005, the MILF kicked out the guys who were really connected to terrorism, JI and the Abu Sayyaf. So even though that's one victory, that they've been able to do that. That only leads to the next problem, you know, which is what happens with all of the other cells below the leadership who continue to grow. They continue to spread this ideology because as long as there's injustice in the Muslim world, they will use that. It's not a religious war. It is one about power.
Mm-hmm.
So they continue to grow. And if you look at 2 days ago in it was just yesterday in Indonesia, 11 people were just arrested for a plot against the U.S. Embassy. And here in the Philippines, in Holo, you had 3 Marines killed because they were trying to go after the group of Radulan Sahiron.
Mm-hmm.
How is this all connected now? It's no longer Al-Qaeda as a top-down leadership. Now it's bottom-up. And they're connecting through Facebook. I give an example of this guy named Khalil Pareja, Filipino guy, arrested here in the Philippines in March. He's in touch on his Facebook page with Al-Qaeda in the Arabian Peninsula, which is the most virulent active group right now of Al-Qaeda. He was, when he was arrested, planning to go there to fight. He was also in touch with a Somalian Al-Qaeda-linked group, Al-Shabaab. They continue to connect with each other, and Facebook is free. It's difficult to, they have different accounts, obviously. It's not in their real name, although some of the ones I've seen are actually in their real names. Mm-hmm. And authorities here in the Philippines are trying to make sense of it. In Indonesia, it's a bigger problem. And here's the difficult part. Governments and intelligence agencies don't understand the internet. In fact,
what do you mean they don't understand the internet?
It's hard when you talk about social media to intelligence agents whose whole lives and whole careers have been about secrecy. Social media is all about, you know, opening up,
yeah,
right? And putting everything out there.
Tell all.
So how do you expect a 50-year-old intelligence agent anywhere around the world to actually understand Facebook, which is, you know, a few of them, some Americans, some Australians, they laugh because they watch their kids, but all of them are like, by design, stay away from
against
anything.
Against it, they don't do it, yeah.
But the
I know
terrorists
someone like
are
that.
There.
Yeah.
You know?
Me.
Yeah, that's right. You're
no,
not on...
but the point there, Maria, is fine, that may be the case, but there are other people who can actually help them and understand it and analyze it for them, right? And just...
Counterterrorism and intelligence is a whole subclass of people. They're obsessive, you know, and they connect the dots behind the scenes. I actually write about some intelligence operations here that they finally allowed me to, but I have tremendous respect for them. They live in a murky world between the criminals and the terrorists and society.
Yeah.
You know that movie, A Few Good Men?
Of course.
I stand on the wall, what I do to keep you safe. Well, that's kind of the way intelligence guys work. They do things that we don't know about and may not pass scrutiny. So for them to actually understand transparency, which is what Facebook does, is a difficult thing. I guess having said that, any government, you know what? Everyone is fascinated by social media. But when you get on social media, it actually means losing control. And so for any organization, government agency, when you go there, you have to go in with that philosophical view, and that's the difficulty. Having said that, what we're seeing is that the terrorists are there, and they're doing it. In Indonesia, for example, it's the sons of the leaders of Jamaah Islamiyah who have created websites that masquerade as news sites, and they have Facebook accounts that actually send out their propaganda, their stories, and they hit millions of people.
Then it's so much easier for them to spread their ideology.
Absolutely.
Or, you know, do some sort of obviously recruitment from social networking sites.
From the safety
it's
of
so
their
easily
rooms.
Now.
It's
yeah.
easy. They don't have to meet them anymore. And they can reach, imagine Khalil Pareja, he's a Filipino.
Yeah,
how else would he have met people in Yemen or like-minded people in Somalia? Through Facebook. This is how he did it. He's in prison now, but there are many more like that. I'll give you
Wait
one
a minute,
more.
Maria, but there's a downside to this. I'm just thinking off my head, even if that was easy, somebody so intelligent working for the government can actually penetrate that and pretend to be a follower, a believer, and actually break that you know, a particular group, or, you know, get more information and evidence.
Yes,
yeah?
And it works both ways, definitely. That's happening, but what we're seeing at least is that there are few agencies that are doing that now.
Really?
But, you know, again, you saw both Twitter and Facebook, the West is a little more advanced than we are. They're able to, they have court subpoenas that actually ask for these things. Here in the Philippines and in Indonesia, we're slow to it. The same way we were slow to actually act. For my team, you know, I was doing these stories as early as 2000 because I just kept covering the bombings mm-hmm. and the protests and the killings. From 1999 to 2000, by our count at CNN at that point, nearly 10,000 people were killed in Muslim-Christian violence in Ambon, Indonesia. But no one put it together with Al-Qaeda or Jamaah Islamiyah, the group that actually wound up fomenting. because it requires digging, and because it wasn't that apparent. It's like the gray area where these news websites news websites are now in Indonesia. Will you shut down a Facebook page that pretends to be, that isn't? It's in the gray area. It's legal, which means it's protected freedom of speech. Indonesia is a democracy, and this is what President Yudhoyono had actually told me. He said, we want to protect that, and we don't want to lose our freedoms to the terrorists. And yet, at the same time, that gives the terrorists greater freedom to move.
And latitude. All right. If, for example, Maria, for those who may not be interested so much
In terrorism,
etc.
Did you see the maps? There are maps. Sorry,
well,
go ahead.
How can you actually tell, you know, entice them to under... Hey, it's the... What is that? That
sociographs. This was done by the core lab, which is in between academics and intelligence. They mapped the world of the book, and then they mapped the connections between the people there. And when you map it, then you have tactical ways to actually get to it.
Mm-hmm.
You can have, there's a financial network here. Like, this is one of the ones that took me a long time. Where did the money come from?
I didn't know you were a chemist, no.
It looks like it, diba? It jumps off this idea of contagion. This is actually a financial network, how money flowed from Osama bin Laden to Abu Bakar, Gaddafi, Abu Bakar Janjalani, down to us. You can see that's the map of how money flowed from Al-Qaeda to the Philippines. Salih Said is Cess's kidnapper. The guy who actually picked them up, Radulan Sahiron, was his boss. The same guy who now is holding the Jordanian guy, the Japanese, and the two Europeans.
They're still there. See, there's a lot of this. For those who might not be too interested in kidnapping.
Oh, so again, you were asking me. Sorry.
No, that's okay. How do you actually tell them that, hey, this is actually good for you? You should actually read this because... it's insightful. So many things to learn from this.
As an author, I learned something from writing the first book to this one. I think what will keep you glued to the book is the story of Cess, Jimmy, and Angel.
You know why? Because it's close to us. I mean, they're Filipinos. They got kidnapped here. I mean, it was the biggest news at that time. I think it was back in 2008.
Yes.
And we were all waiting for good news, even I.
Yes, it was, you know, again, I was... When I was writing it, I thought,
Why did you decide to write about her kidnapping, their kidnapping, rather? It's not just Cess, it's Jimmy and Angel, of course.
Because I think that, you know, strangely, and you know I'm not that religious, I believe there's a God, but I really felt like it was all the experience we had, we used in that instance. And if we didn't have it, we couldn't have made the decisions, we couldn't have acted the way we did.
But you got a lot of support.
Read the book.
Really?
I mean, what you will see.
At least that's what I thought.
What you will see is you don't know whom to trust.
Okay.
You know, you will realize that
it is about
trust. And, you know, we put our trust in government institutions to a degree, but they don't work.
Not completely.
In fact, in this part of the Philippines, it's about a breakdown of law and order. So who do you trust?
Yeah.
That was the big question. But I think the other thing there is that it's who will take responsibility. You know, when a kidnapping happens, right now the Australians have a guy, Rodwell, who's been kidnapped last December. It's going to come up to a year.
Wow.
Who is going to make the decision and stake their lives, in quotes, you know, their professional lives on the line? I thought about it. And in our team, when we talked about it, someone actually said, why don't we just let the authorities do it? Why do we go in? And I just responded, can we live with not doing that? What if something happened to them? And we could have done something, but we didn't. And I think that's part of the problem. Not enough people say, I'm going to do something and take a risk and risk myself. Because if I don't, it could be worse for these people, for the people who were there. And, you know, I write about that also. Here we go again. I write about it because I thought, when I asked Gabby, our chairman, for the full authority, because I knew it was going to be a matter of minutes and days to get them out. When I asked him for full authority to act, he gave it immediately. This was like in the first phone call after. But I also knew that if I screwed up, that I would take the blame for it.
Absolutely.
And my God, if something had happened to them, I couldn't have lived with that. So yun, parang, That, I think, is part of what's missing.
Understandable, yeah. Accountability, responsibility, taking that risk.
But if you go much further up the chain, Martin and Gracia Burnham, everyone who's been kidnapped, I then realize why they stay there as long as they have.
Why?
Because the people who are in charge will not risk their political careers for people like this. They don't know them. They got there and they can let the machinery work.
Yeah.
But when the machinery works, it doesn't work.
All right. 10 days, 10 years from Bin Laden to Facebook. This is Maria's second book. Seeds of Terror was the first one. She launched this about 3 weeks ago, I think, huh?
Yeah. Coming up. Yeah. October 12th.
Yeah. Okay. October 12th. So please get a copy. Parang ako yung author. Please get a copy of Maria's book. Maria, why don't you invite them? I'll let you do the inviting.
I specifically ask that Anvil, that the Philippines, be given the first edition. The British publisher will be coming out with a hardcover and the digital edition in early next year. But this is something I think that is very Filipino. It is ours. It's something that will be useful for us. It shows you how things really work. If you're just interested in the story is there. And you get a great picture of Sess, Jimmy, and Angel, the characters, the fantastic people that they are. You get a picture of the insides of ABS-CBN and how it works. Actually, it's everything. It's all there. And at the same time, you get that in the context of a global fight against terrorism. Thank you having me.
Maria Ressa, thanks a lot. Good to see you, Maria.
It's good to be here.
We'll give you the latest from the stock market. And boxing champ Manny Pacquiao arrives in the U.S. to begin his 6-week training. The details when Mornings at ANC returns.
If it looks imported and feels